Back to the lead. Time now for the buried lead. That's what we call stories that we don't think have gotten enough attention. In this story, there was actually something literally buried. Evidence that proved a man was locked away for a quarter century for a crime he did not commit. Michael Morton was convicted in 1987 of killing his wife, Christine, even though he repeatedly denied it. In the documentary, An Unreal Dream, airing tonight on CNN, Morton recounts his confidence that he would be found not guilty.
I didn't think I was going to get convicted. It was going to be a longish trial, but then it would be revealed that there can be no there. There's nothing to convict. There's nothing hard. There's nothing that says, look, this guy did it. There's nothing beyond a reasonable doubt. And I couldn't imagine what could possibly be manufactured to make 12 people think that I'd killed my wife.
He was wrong. He was sentenced to life and spent 25 years in prison before his attorneys and a group called the Innocence Project found holes in his conviction. They discovered that a blood-stained bandana police found near the crime scene was never DNA tested. It proved that a convicted felon named Mark Norwood was the real killer. Michael Morton was freed in 2011. Norwood was convicted of Christine's murder earlier this year, and police believe he killed another woman, Deborah Baker, in 1988. Our own Ashley Banfield spoke with Mark Morton and asked how he felt about being wrongly convicted.
A lot of anger inside, and I felt like I was justified at the time. But today and now, I understand that that sort of anger and revenge and hate isn't going to help you any. But the one thing that will work that people should and often do latch onto is transparency and accountability.
While this case has a somewhat happy ending with Morton trying to build a relationship with his now adult son, we have to ask how many innocent men and women sit in prison right now when DNA evidence could exonerate them? I want to bring in Chris Asplen. He's a former federal prosecutor who's now the director for the Alliance for Rapid DNA Testing. Chris, thanks for being here. I know you followed this case closely. What do you make of the fact that there was evidence, this bandana with blood and hair, that was never tested for DNA?
Well, it's certainly a tragedy. It's a tragedy in a number of ways. It's a tragedy not only for what happened to Michael's life, but what happened to his sons and his relationships. It was also a tragedy for what happened to Deborah Baker and the fact that she was killed when, if we had identified the right perpetrator early on, rather than have this tunnel vision for Michael Morton, we very may well have prevented her murder also.
We should note that the prosecutor in this case from 1987 is named Ken Anderson. He briefly served time in jail last month for criminal contempt of court involving this case. We have a statement from his attorney, Eric Nichols, that we have to read. Quote, Mr. Anderson has not been and never will be prosecuted for any alleged crime in connection with the Michael Morton trial or any subsequent proceeding relating to the Morton trial. In light of the DNA results obtained in 2011, Mr. Anderson has consistently expressed and continues to express to Mr. Morton and his family his regret for Mr. Morton's prosecution and incorrect incarceration, unquote. But how common is this, Chris, where a prosecutor is involved in the withholding of evidence for whatever reason?
You know, it's a system run by human beings, and so there are going to be times when humans fail. We don't know how many times wrongful convictions are the result of prosecutor misconduct. It's really probably not that many. We certainly don't have many instances where prosecutors have been subsequently pursued for their misdeeds originally. But actually, that's not the bigger problem. The bigger number of cases that we need to be concerned about are all those cases wherein prosecutors do the right thing and they think they've got it right, where witnesses all think they've got the right person, where the other forensic evidence seems to point to that person, and we still get it wrong. That's really the larger number by far are the cases in which the system appears to work well and then just doesn't because we don't look at the kind of evidence that we can look at now.
And give us an idea of what DNA testing was like in 1987 when Morton was convicted compared to where we are now.
Well, it was very, very, very rudimentary at that stage. Very few places were actually doing DNA testing at all. Admissibility wars were still being fought throughout the country to try to get it legal in the courts. We are now light years ahead of that. Originally, what we went through with DNA was to try to make it reliable and very discriminatory, And the technology was designed to try to do more with less. In other words, how can we get a good profile from smaller and smaller pieces of evidence? Now that we can get DNA profiles from evidence we can't even see, now the issue is, how do we do it more quickly? Now it's reliability and speed, because when you're doing DNA testing, how quickly you get to do that testing may literally save someone's life.
All right.